My name is Donald Tarter, Sociology Department at the University of Alabama in Huntsville. We're participating here in a project by the University of Alabama in Huntsville to record some of the recollections of the people who stood at the very origins of the space age. The space age, as commonly perceived, began on October the 4th, 1957, when the Soviets launched Sputnik into Earth orbit. But in reality, space historians date the real beginning of the space age some 15 years and one day earlier, to October the 3rd, 1942, when the German A-4 rocket was launched from Peenemünde and went into the dimension of space. Today we have with us two individuals that were there at the beginning, at that very first launch, and who played a key role in that very first launch. Today we want to ask them questions about what they felt then, what they feel now about the present status of the space program, and where they think the space program will be going in the future. To my immediate left here is Dr. Gerhard Reisig. Dr. Reisig has been a longtime resident of Huntsville. Dr. Reisig was in charge of the tracking systems for the original A-4 launch. And Dr. Reisig has been very active in the academic and intellectual circles here in Huntsville for a number of years. To my far left is Mr. Conrad Dannenberg. Mr. Conrad Dannenberg, of course, like Dr. Reisig, was a member of that original group of scientists and engineers from the Peenemünde team, the paperclip group, as very often designated in the history of science and technology. Mr. Dannenberg, of course, has a long and distinguished career in the history of rocketry, being past president of the American Rocket Society, and also very active in the local activities of the Alabama Space and Rocket Center, even after his retirement, after many long and distinguished years with NASA. Dr. Reisig, I'll start with you. That day in 1942, when you saw that bird leave Earth, did you have that sense of what it meant historically? Did this thing to you, what does it feel like to stand at the dawn of a new age? That's basically what I'm trying to say.
Of course, we were very much excited that we finally accomplished to bring such a heavy body into what we call space now, which we defined more or less at the beyond the boundary of the atmosphere. As I knew from my tracking results, we went just above the atmosphere at a maximum altitude of 83 kilometers and found out very soon that we almost hit the 200 kilometers mark. So this experience, of course, was very unique because never before such a body was launched to such a height and to such a distance in such a short time. We had about a time of flight of 5 minutes for this distance. And we immediately had the feeling that we opened the door into a big future and finally proved that our concepts were realistic and achievable, and that just about logically everything else might follow out of that. For going into real interplanetary space.
Mr. Dannenberg, I suppose you shared that feeling as well.
Of course, I was very happy at that time, since up to that period we had made many, many tests on the test stands. I was in charge of the propulsion system, the power plant for the V2, including the tanks and the tank pressurization system. And we had many, many problems. Very often when we went after a month's hard work to the test site and push the button, in most cases the whole propulsion system blew up, and therefore this of course was really a crowning accomplishment that we finally were so far that we had solved these basic very early initial problems, and that we had finally a power plant which could lift the rocket into outer space and fulfill the military mission that was required of the V2 or the A4 as we called it at that time. The A4 was of course a technical name. It stood for aggregate, in order to be not too specific what kind of aggregate. Aggregate is just any apparatus that was used for this purpose. And of course, we were very happy that finally we were so far that the propulsion system could work for about a minute's duration in order to accomplish the 5 minutes of flight time. We had prior to that launch already some mishaps, some malfunctioning launches, and so this was really a very great step forward. And I fully agree with you what you said in the beginning. I personally think this was the beginning of the present-day space age.
Right. And when all the technical details were settled and when your mission was accomplished, so to speak, and that evening when you were able to relax a bit and reflect upon what you had done, did your mind go racing out across the decades and think that this might indeed lead in a few decades to where we are now on the verge of putting a space station program into to being?
I don't think we did it the first evening. Of course, we first had a big party, we had a few beers and celebrated that way. We talked about the problems which still were known. We had some very simple, very primitive measurements during the flight, so we knew what still had to be improved, what still had to be corrected. We had not reached the entire fully expected range, so some additional work had to be done, and I think most of our conversations really concentrated on that thing. On the other hand, of course, a few days later, we also talked about the potential future, and I think I personally was really influenced quite a bit already by the book that Professor Overt had written, where he talked already in those days about much, much more advanced activities than just launching V2s. He talked already about space stations. He talked about individuals floating around in free outer space. And every once in a while, we talked about these things. Also, they were certainly not in the forefront of our discussions. So most of our problems were everyday, daily problems, still worrying about proper functioning of the power plant, proper ignition, proper operation, and no burning through of the engine, which had to be cooled by the fuel in order to take these very high combustion temperatures. So that are the things we concentrated on in those days.
Right. You mentioned Professor Overt, and right before this conversation, today's date, incidentally, is April the 24th, 1984. Dr. Reisig has informed me that he is about to leave in a few weeks for Germany and to see Professor Overt, who is now turning 90 years of age. And you might want to say a few words about his contribution to the entire program. He, too, was a resident of Huntsville for a short while back in the 1950s, and you might want to say just a few words about his contributions.
Well, we consider Professor Overt the father of rocketry. I think he inspired any of our team, any one of our team, for real go to for big achievements. He, I think, in the early 20s already published his major work, the travel of the flight into outer space, and he was very much ahead in his concepts and his thinking of what actually could be accomplished by space in terms of space technology. Now, of course, we had to learn from him on the theoretical side. He, I may say that he was not the, the very practical man. So he once made a statement that the accomplishments of the Werner von Braun team could only be accomplished by the team and not by himself or by anybody else, as he, as far as he knew. So I think it was a real mutual giving. He inspired us with his ideas, and we try to put it in technical reality. And we think very highly of him, and we, I should say we love him. He's a very amiable person. Personally, I had the privilege to receive him here in this country. I was sent to New York to pick him up at the steamboat, and he came over and had to take him to Huntsville. But of course, I have seen him over in Europe, and we are very happy that he's still with us and that we can celebrate his 90th birthday in Salzburg in Austria in the meeting of the German Rocket Society. As a matter of fact, we call it Hermann Oberth Society.
Aha. Well, that should be very interesting. It's very difficult for theorists and practitioners to get together, but you seem to have bridged that gap.
It was a very heavy marriage. Yeah.
In the social sciences, we're not quite that good at bridging the gap. But Mr. Denenberg, looking back over the history of the space program, what's probably the biggest surprise to you in the way that it's developed as opposed to the way that in those very early days you thought it might develop?
Of course, the V2 was only the very first, in a way, very hesitant step. And Obert, for example, about whom we just talked, he proposed to use as propellants liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen. And of course, V2 used only ethyl alcohol because it burns relatively coolly. We could control those combustion temperatures. There was no way of using, in those days, liquid hydrogen. And even to produce and to manufacture liquid oxygen for the V2 was already a major effort. We had to have our own plants for this purpose. You could not go anywhere else and buy it. You had to make it yourself. So that was a big step. And of course, when we came over to this country, when I came over to this country, I don't know if it goes also for Dr. Reisig, I had, of course, expected that we would build more military vehicles. After all, the V2 was a military vehicle, and I had seen that we would build bigger ones, missiles with a greater range, maybe missiles with a greater target accuracy. We were fully aware that the target accuracy of the V2 was not as great as you probably would like it. So certain improvements should be expected in that area. And that, of course, was the first big step in this country when the von Braun team developed and built the Redstone vehicle. That had much improved target accuracy. It was basically otherwise still a grown-up V2, so it was not a real big step ahead. And these steps came a little bit later when the United States really got into the missile race with the Russians. It was known that the Russians were building their ICBM, their intercontinental ballistic missile, with a range of at least 5,000 miles compared with about 200 miles for the V2. So that was a real big step. And I think I had expected this kind of activity at the time when we came over. What happened after the ICBM, that is in a way a surprise to me. Firstly, of course, a decision by General Eisenhower at that time, or President Eisenhower, I should better say, to make the NASA effort a civilian activity. I had really not expected that such a thing would happen. So I was maybe thinking a little bit more in the European fashion. I don't think the Germans would have established a civilian space agency, and certainly, of course, the Russians didn't do it. And also, as far as I know, most of the other nations who work on spaceflight, and there are many of them, the Indians, the Chinese, the Japanese, they have all one unified space program. They don't have the difference between military activities and civilian activities. On the other hand, I must say I appreciated that very, very much. Of course, for military work, everything was classified. You always had to watch your language. You could never talk openly about all the things you did. And that, of course, changed drastically when we became finally a member of the NASA team. And then, of course, the real great adventures started to happen. The huge launch vehicles, initially the clustered Redstones and Jupiters, which we called Saturn 1, Saturn 1B a little later. And then, of course, the final moon rocket, the Saturn V. And I must say, I'm still impressed today that you could build a rocket taller than a football field is long, more than 100 meters high, 360 feet high, and that you could put that thing on the launch pad and lift it up first into an orbit and then finally let the rest of the vehicle take some payloads all the way to the moon. And I must say, I'm still impressed today that we have done that already. I personally was, again, as I said earlier, probably quite a bit influenced by Obert's thinking. I would have expected possibly a space station as the next follow-on to military activities after NASA had been established. But I'm today still surprised that the first step was all the way to the moon.
Dr. Reisig, does that go for you as well? Did you expect to be an employee of the military for the rest of your professional life?
Well, I wasn't so sure about that. Of course, in Peenemünde already we were speculating somewhat about our activities in peacetime and mm-hmm. the war would have been over. Of course, it took quite a different course. Well, as you asked Mr. Denenberg the question, what the biggest surprise for him was, and on my part, I should say, the most surprising thing was the continuous acceleration of the results of our developments. You see, when we accomplished the real first space flight in 1942 with an A-4 missile, the next best thing I think we thought of was a satellite. But after we came over to this country, that within less than 20 years, or exactly, yeah, less than 20 years, that we would land on the moon was not quite conceivable. And the reason that we accomplished it, or that it was in general accomplished, was the continuous acceleration of the accomplishments in our developments. Mm-hmm. And of course, that is most likely a result of the very general resources we were allowed to receive from, let's say, American people,
right,
after
mm-hmm.
all.
Mr. Dannenberg made what I consider to be a very interesting point from the standpoint of being a sociologist and being interested in how science and technology work and in the developmental mm-hmm. process. He noted the fact that a civilian agency was easier to work with, in a sense, than a military agency, because you could talk openly, you could exchange ideas. Did you experience the same sort of feeling about this? What were your feelings about the civilian science versus the military science as they progressed along?
Well, of course, you see, I'm myself a physicist. I'm more or less on the scientific side, and of course we couldn't anticipate, and we appreciated that with a civilian organization, the scientific part of the space activities would have a much heavier weight than in the military operations, of course. On the other hand, the organization of the whole activities was somewhat different, mainly, as in Peenemünde already, because of the secrecy we had to rely on ourselves. When we changed over to the civilian operations with NASA, we felt at once that the industry was much more interested to take a part. So in a certain way, if I may say that, we felt that was a little bit taken away from us.
Aha, uh-huh. Right.
See, we had a very unusual, at least in business-like or industrial terms, we had a very a unique operation, because we did everything under one roof in Peenemünde and in the military operations here. When we turned over to the civilian operation, we had to interchange with industry and business, and that did not always go smoothly,
uh-huh.
because the industry wanted to have a certain saying and things. Yeah? Right. And looking back, I think I can make the statements that the efficiency of the operation when you had everything under one roof was higher than when you had to respect the feelings and the methods of industry. For instance, a typical thing was that as well in Peenemünde as here in the military operations, and even the first time the NASA, we produced the first or the prototypes of our space vehicles or rockets ourselves. That's very unusual in any kind of operation which works with government money, because the industry thinks it's their privilege to start right at the beginning with at least the hardware aspect. But looking at that from a little bit more scientific point of view, I should say we had the concept that the manufacturing part was essentially also a scientific problem. We learned a lot from our own experience with manufacturing prototypes, and then could have the industry profit from our so-called scientific industrial accomplishments or experiences.
Uh-huh. So you share somewhat different opinions about the virtues of civilian technology as opposed to a unified sort of technological approach. One question that I did want to try to bring out, we asked you what was the biggest surprise to you over the past history of the development of the space program. What's been the biggest disappointment? Mr. Dannenberg, would you Care to comment about that?
Well, in a way, I indicated already earlier, I'm in a way disappointed that we don't have a space station going today. If we would have played the lunar landing program a little bit differently, we could have had the space station, so to speak, almost for free at the same time. After all, we put our lunar payload first into an Earth orbit anyway, and we probably could have done that with a smaller Saturn-1 or Saturn-1B launch vehicle, which I mentioned earlier, which was quite a bit smaller than the Saturn-5. It would have required more than one launch, though. We could not have lifted the very heavy payload that finally had to fly to the moon. In one launch, we would have required about 5, 6, maybe even up to 8 launches. And too many people were reluctant. Missilery, even in those days, was not so reliable that you could schedule a number of 8 launches within a relatively short period of time, let's say 2 weeks, to get all your equipment into an orbit, to get also your propellants, which at that time, of course, had become, according to Obert's recommendations, liquid oxygen, liquid hydrogen, finally. And with liquid hydrogen, you have a storage problem. If you have to keep that for too long in your vehicle in orbit, then you have so much vaporization that you just don't keep your tanks full. So you had to do the assembly in space in a relatively short time, and too many people were reluctant. And that was the reason that it finally was decided by NASA to build one big launch vehicle, the Saturn-5 launch vehicle, which could carry the entire payload in one launch to the moon.
Uh-huh. Right. I can remember reading in the science fiction of the early 1950s that a space station would probably precede a lunar mission. And so that to you is a disappointment that we don't already have that.
Right.
Uh-huh. What about you, Dr. Reisig? What's your major disappointment in the way that the programs have gone, the way that you hope that they
will
go?
I should say my main aspect of this, with regard to this question, is more on a personal side. I should say my real big disappointment was the assassination of President Kennedy. I remember very well. I was in White Sands at this very moment at. On TDY, I was terribly shocked because I had the feeling we really lost something very essential for the future of our space efforts. in my opinion, President Kennedy was really a man with vision, and he never found any other individual which could match him. And so I felt we lost something big.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And to be very honest with you, the second big disappointment was when Werner von Braun left the team here in Huntsville.
Uh-huh.
In a certain way, they had to say we lost our roof.
Right.
See, we were so tightly knitted team that one part relied absolutely on the other, that I had personally the feeling it was a big loss too, and I'm afraid from that very point on, at least the efficiency of our efforts went down. We had an entirely different kind of operations than you see, von Braun was of course our manager, but actually he was our spiritual leader, and we lost him. And from his departure on, this management part in our operations was more and more emphasized.
Mm-hmm.
And in my opinion, this means a loss of efficiency.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yes, those two very charismatic and dynamic personalities, President Kennedy and Werner von Braun, were both able to just capture people's imagination and turn the public imagination to the space program. And you don't see anyone on the immediate horizon that can do the same thing, that can capture the public attention for the program as those two individuals did.
At least I wouldn't know anybody.
Right.
At the moment.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to ask you next to do something that's perhaps very, very difficult. In fact, we know that it's impossible, and that's to begin to envision the future to some extent. When any of us attempt to try to make statements about what will happen, we eventually look foolish. But we have to try to use our best judgment and best imagination to venture guesses about what will and what should happen in the next few years of the development of this pioneering technology. So I wanted to pose to both of you the questions of where do you see, say, in the next 25 years, you can venture further than that if you would like, but where do you see us being in terms of our major developments in space a quarter of a century from now? Mr. Denenberg?
Well, we mentioned earlier the space station, and it almost sounded, in retrospect now, like we had a space station. Of course, we don't have it. It has been proposed by NASA to build one. President Reagan has gone along with it, but Congress has not yet approved it. And I think we will still see a relatively difficult fight ahead, and it may happen again that the space station is put on the back burner again and that we don't proceed with it. That, of course, would be really, in my opinion, a very sad mistake if we would make it. After all, the Russians are working with their second space station in orbit right now. They have recently invited an Indian to join them up there and do some work with them. They have Frenchmen, have had Frenchmen up there, and of course practically representatives from all the eastern states, East Germany, Poland, Romania, all these people have had their cosmonauts on board of the Russian space station. And I'm sure they are going to go ahead and they are going to learn many, many things which we have not been able to learn yet. So I hope as a first step, we really get the final approval to build a space station. And I hope it is not so much a poor man's space station, like some people seem to indicate. I hope we can really do the necessary things so that also the scientific people really get their value out of a space station. I'm afraid if it's a poor man's effort like the shuttle was in a way, that all the science has to be put on the back burner and we might make a lot of scientists very disenchanted about this situation. And of course, I personally hope that eventually, not necessarily the United States by themselves, but hopefully as an international venture, would build a much, much larger space station, something which I sometimes refer to as a space colony, something along the lines of what Jerry O'Neill proposed, Jerry O'Neill of Princeton. He also called it a space colony, where really hundreds and possibly even thousands or even millions of people live in outer space, possibly even their entire life. When we now talk about the presently visualized Marshall Station or the NASA station, or even what President Reagan has in mind, it's still only a 6 to 12 minute affair, and the people will go up for maybe half a year. That probably would be already the maximum time of their duration in stay, duration in orbit, and then they would come back. So that's not the final effort I really see in this area. I really see something that some people call a space habitat, or that some people refer to as a space colony. And that also would be a little bit more what von Braun visualized. I'm sure everyone is aware of von Braun's Collier's article series, where he proposed a huge cylindrical spinning wheel, where through the spinning of the wheel, you generate artificial gravity, either at the 1G level or possibly at the somewhat lower level, only half a G, but where then really the people could live and work like down here on Earth, on board of such a space station. What President Reagan mentioned is a far, far cry from this big step. So we are still a long, long shot away from that. And I'm personally sure that something in that area will be done. I also see some efforts going on again in the further conquest of the moon. Ovid mentioned in his book already going to the asteroids, and he didn't call it mining of the asteroids, as some people say today, but he wanted to drill holes into the asteroids that he could live and stay there. I see that coming, and of course, von Braun's final dream, just before he passed away, was of course to really have a Mars mission. And I also think that this Mars mission will be started one of these days from a space station. So I think we really need a space station as a stepping stone, as a starting out point in order to get such a very major venture underway. So I don't see that, certainly not this century. It probably will be the middle of next century that we really start a manned mission to Mars again.
So you would imagine a manned mission to Mars in the middle of the next century. I know you've been very active in the L5 Society, which is a group that actively promotes Jerry O'Neill's ideas about space colonization, space habitats, and so forth. What's your best guess there? Perhaps 100 years from now, some person will pick up this old videotape, dust it off, put it on a machine, and here we are in 1984, trying to guess maybe about the year 2084. Will we have an O'Neill colony in 2084?
I would guess that at 2084, about 100 years from now, we have a pretty fair chance to have a huge habitat of the O'Neill type. But as you said earlier, of course, we are all guessing right now. You don't know how these things go. It will involve quite a bit of resources, so somebody has to make this basic decision, which has not even been made yet for our present poor man's space station.
Dr. Rising, what are your views of tomorrow? What's on the horizon?
Well, again, in line with some emphasis on the scientific aspects of space activities, and on the other hand, you know that I'm a follower of cybernetic concepts. In other words, to design systems which have the highest return for a certain effort. And so my opinion is that the best thing and the most economical thing and the most systematic thing we could do now to establish a settlement on the moon. The moon is our natural satellite. And we might avoid or overcome a number of essential shortcomings of at least the present space vehicles as we experience them. For instance, there were some second thoughts about the accomplishments with the place, with the space lab, that some things don't work out as they were envisioned. For instance, treatment of materials in zero gravity or very low gravity. And it turned out that these experiments need a very quiet or solid basis. And they found out, the astronauts found out that even the movements of the astronauts within the space stations generates all right, it is such a level of vibrations that the experiment might fail. And if you have a solid body like the moon as a basis, these problems would disappear. On the other hand, I'm very much interested in astrophysics and the non-atmosphere of the moon, the absolutely material-free environment of the moon would favor very much reaching out in the far space. With the instrumentation, at least we can visualize at this moment or at our age. And as Mr. Dunberg said, we are meddling around a little bit with the poor man's solutions. And if, in my opinion, if you go to the moon, you could establish something real fashionable up there with not too high expenses, because you have a solid basis to build on. And as a matter of fact, as far as I'm informed, we could start today or tomorrow with such an experience, because there are still Saturn V's available. We could go up to the moon without any further development of the vehicles and just concentrate on the establishment of the settlement on a, as I said before, on a solid basis. And of course, we could accommodate the people which have to go up there, which could be in a much larger number than in any floating space station, could accommodate these people to really defined conditions. You would know the conditions on the moon very clearly and could keep the people up there for a long period of time, which would have a very significant scientific meaning, because many of the experiments which we have done already or which people like to do need a long duration, a period of observations. And so far, with any space station we can visualize now, we will always be limited with the period of operation. We have to break up the experiments in the middle of the it's the most exciting moment, but with the moon, things could go on for forever, so to speak. So I think even you have to consider, you never will have a pocket which is always full of money. You will get a certain amount of money which a taxpayer is willing to give you, and under these aspects, with a cybernetic approach, I think you would have the best return of the money you will get if you establish a basis on the moon.
Right. Those people who handle the space budgets are torn between competing interpretations of what should be our future in space. Mr. Dannenberg has mentioned the role of space stations. You have more strongly emphasized the role of the lunar station. There are also those people that strongly emphasize the role of planetary missions and the exploration of the planets via unmanned spacecraft. What about that? To what extent do you foresee that being a viable program in the future? Or have we done about all that we can reasonably do within the solar system now? Do you think that we should have our resources going more to manned space activity right now? Or should we enrich the program for planetary exploration?
Well, I think you should go after the things which are most obvious. Big disappointment to me, since I'm very much interested in astrophysics, is that NASA did not establish a project to observe the Halley Comet. The Europeans are doing that. I think it's a big omission. It's negligence of a real scientific purpose to do something. So in my opinion, the most healthy approach for the future would be a reasonable mixture between manned missions and planetary missions with automatic gadgets, or what you like to call the space vehicles. Certain things, as I mentioned before, probably have to be done the robot way. You know that robotics is now the thing in manufacturing and industry, and we should in our space efforts take big advantage of the rapid development of robotics, which calls or which suggests unmanned space vehicles to a large extent. And again, it will be so that these automatic devices might be able to do experiments to a higher perfection than a man ever can do. So, as I say, in my opinion, the most reasonable thing would be a sound, solid mixture of both kinds of missions.
Well, both of you have mentioned the fact that we are doing poor man's programs. Maybe the way that we could enrich those programs would be to seek a greater extent of international cooperation in these programs. You may have a sense of the feeling of the international community for their desires for the future. Which programs, which type of programs do you feel that we could get greater international support on? The lunar missions, the space satellite missions, or the planetary missions? Mr. Dannenberg?
Of course, Dr. Reisig touched already briefly on that. He pointed out that the Europeans are having their Halley Comet mission. We don't do too much in that area. We have a few very minor efforts going in that area. So I'm sure the Europeans would also in the future certainly support similar programs. And we should also not forget that the Europeans, of course, have built and designed and furnished free to NASA the space lab. And they are very anxious to have more space lab flights in the future, and it looks like there will be quite a number of space lab flights. And space lab is built and designed in such a way that you can use modules, elements of it, relatively easily for a space station. Now that may still be a political decision. Do we want to use these existing available elements, which are not always necessarily the optimum solution? The optimum solution is sometimes a brand new design where you can really start from scratch and meet all your requirements. I personally think it would be sad if we for that reason would leave the Europeans out and if they could not participate. So I'm very hopeful, in order to also be able to build a somewhat larger space station, that they would have a relatively major role, a key role, and that they also can determine jointly with NASA and with the United States some of the primary approaches. What do we want to do with such a station? How big should it be? And I also would like to point out, when we talk about a space station, we really don't talk only about one element. sometimes talking about a space station, you get that impression that's only one place in space. Even NASA, and that's why they talk about architecture of a space station, they see a number of smaller elements like the space telescope, which works jointly with the space station, but which is in a way a free-flying element. And as Dr. Isaac pointed out, we probably have to do something along that line for manufacturing in space. Because if we keep the manufacturing facilities in space inside of our space station, every little bumping, every little docking, every little correction of our orbit will have an effect on it. So we do need separately, independently flying stations. And again, for cybernetics reasons, in order to make it as easy as possible to get to our space station, the main activities will be in a relatively easy orbit from Cape Kennedy in 28.5-degree inclined orbit to the Earth in a relatively low altitude, I would guess about 300 miles, maybe a little bit higher up, but not very much higher up. But there are many payloads where you want to do Earth observations, where you want to do communications with other Earth centers in a much lower orbit. And so I see quite a number of polar activities most likely going on in a way fairly independent second activity, which I hope can also be a part of our presently approved space station. So I hope the size of what we do will include such activities. And of course, one of the real desirable space stations is to get into a geosynchronous orbit, what some people call the Arthur Clarke orbit, because Arthur Clarke was the first one to propose it. That's one idea that OVA did not have, to go into geosynchronous orbit and stay over the same point on Earth all the time, so that you can always communicate with that part of the Earth and that you can observe that part of the Earth in very great detail. So I see quite a number of activities also for a geosynchronous station, which is relatively difficult to obtain though. So this activity probably will be unmanned for quite a number of years to come. I also see this kind of space station being realized before we go back to the moon. I don't quite agree with Dr. Isaac in that area. The three Saturn V's which are still left over, well, one of them we have at the Space Center, and I know in what sad shape it is. To bring it back into flying condition would require a major effort, and I think it would be much cheaper to use a space shuttle for the same kind of purpose in a way. To do, of course, some orbital assembly. We would have to do now finally orbital assembly in order to get from there then finally back to the moon. So I don't quite agree with you that we still have the hardware available. And of course, to build new Saturn V's would be very, very costly, very expensive. And we also do not have the launch facilities at the Cape anymore. They all have been modified for the space shuttle, and we would have to make a major decision what to do at the Cape for the actual launch.
You mentioned there briefly Arthur Clarke. Of course, Arthur Clarke has been one of the great visionaries of the space age. And here we are in 1984, and in a recent novel, Arthur Clarke has just suggested another idea, which at this particular time sounds almost so incredible that very few people are taking it seriously. And that is actually constructing an elevator type of apparatus to the Clarke orbit, to the geosync orbit. Could you imagine such a thing? Is it possible? Will it be? Will we not travel in rockets to the Clarke orbit, but perhaps?
Well, I think I'm in that area one of the skeptics. I just don't see how you can accomplish it. It sounds like a great idea, I have to admit it. And if we had it, you could just ride your elevator up to your space station, and it would be a real cheap thing. But in order to go there, to get there, you have to build a structure which, in my opinion, cannot be built at this time with our existing technologies. You either have to erect it from the Earth, and it would be very, very heavy to reach all the way up to your space station, or you would have to let it down from the space station and come down here. And again, we don't have the materials that can take this load, because this initial elevator shaft, so to speak, has a weight. It is not weightless. And that's where I see the problem. So it sounds like a real good idea, but I don't see the technical realization at this time.
Any comments about that, Dr. Riley?
Well, I like to take a kind of a historic view in that. I think it's surprising, even to the people who were working on it, that the basic technology we are applying now to our spacecraft, the whole system, is practically the same thing which we did in Peenemünde. if you go to the Space Museum here and look at the different models, you will find always the same elements which we already designed in Peenemünde. So there must be a natural kind of optimum how to do things. And I wonder whether the ideas of Clark would be so superior to what has been proven in almost 50 years now to spend the effort and do it.
Well, we'll see if he is still the Da Vinci of the space age 100 years from now or not. That's an idea yet to be tested. One sort of final exploration I'd like to open with you is, you've already mentioned that there's a great number of demands on the space program for monies in this program or that program. One of the most controversial areas of the public policy decisions now affecting the space program lies in the militarization of space. President Reagan has recently proposed what is being called the Star Wars concept. Some people say that it would take perhaps $500 billion to fully implement it. Some people argue that it may take monies away from more productive means of developing the space frontier. Others say that it is necessary. I wanted to sort of explore this dimension with you and see what your ideas were about that. Mr. Dannenberg?
Well, I don't have a very clear-cut opinion on that subject. On the other hand, I see that all the other nations are practically in space in a military way. I think the Chinese mostly are interested in space because they see the military value of it. And the Russians, of course, they do basically everything they do with a military background. And once we would make real great progress, let's say once we would have a real ambitious space station in orbit, I almost see that we will be forced to do something in the military area also to protect our investment, to protect our station. And of course, many people in the military are already quite a bit concerned, and that's, I think, a part behind Reagan's thinking. What do we do with all our communication systems if the Russians really have the capability to shoot down all our communication satellites? Most of our communications, most of our day-to-day technical industrial activities are based on satellite communications. And the military, of course, depends on these quite as much. And if we don't find a much, much better agreement with the Russians as the one we have right now, and maybe even with all the other nations, and even poor nations now start to get into space flight, if we don't really have a firm of a peace treaty with them, I think we will be forced to do something on our end too. So I just don't see how we can avoid staying with the military out of space. I think it will automatically move into that area.
Dr. Isaac, do you share that opinion?
Well, I have to admit I'm somewhat confused about this issue. I'm of the opinion there's already an agreement with Russia not to use the space for war purposes, for military purposes. Now, quite a sudden, it's a big topic, so I don't know actually what's going on. And in a certain way, it looks to me like an effort to escape the military problems on the Earth. You see, there is evidently a balance now with this nuclear war weapons, and nobody knows in which direction to move to get absolute security. So they go out in space and try it there. Whether that's reasonable, that's to me a very, very open question. And I think the problems you have to solve are so formidable that you first have to make very intricate and very conscious analytical studies whether the whole thing would be feasible. And I don't think that anybody can make a firm statement in this direction yet. I just don't know enough about it, or which approaches would be worthwhile to be followed. And maybe the whole thing is, to a certain extent, a propaganda piece.
Mm-hmm. Well, on the military issue, I know that scientists and engineers that have been associated with other developments in military technology, particularly now I'm thinking about those with the Oppenheimer Group at the Manhattan Project, many of those people became very vocal in their expression of the fears of the drift toward military use of their technology that they had pioneered and developed. I know for a fact that Mr. Denenberg here has been very active in working with an organization called the International Association of Educators for World Peace. And he's also expressed concerns about the peaceful use of space technology as opposed to military usage. Dr. Reisig, what are your views about this? What do you think that you, as one of the people that helped develop this new age of technology, what is your responsibility to communicate to people that your hopes and wishes that it be used peacefully?
Well, I think it's a big educational problem. in terms of technology, we are beyond the age of wars. See, if you go back 150 years or more than that, in the early 19th century, there was this German military philosopher von Clausewitz. I think he's still considered the outstanding philosopher in the military area. And he said, if there should be any war, the purpose of a war would be a better peace. Now, with the present military technology, which better peace could you expect? Probably none. Would be total destruction. So, as I say, there is a kind of a priority now on Earth, and they try to escape to space to look for another possibility to overcome the other nations. And again, I can't visualize anything reasonable which would guarantee or which make achievable a better peace. I suppose the outcome of such technical efforts, military and military technology, would be just as bad destruction as the means we have on Earth now. And the educational problem is now to make even particular our younger generations aware of the situation. There is no reason for a war anymore on Earth, because there's no better peace can be anticipated with our military technology. So people have to come to a reasonable basis and realize the problems of the other side and try to accommodate themselves as much as you expect that the other will be. And the only means to do that is, in my opinion, adequate and proper education.
Mr. Denenberg, your thoughts on the same subject?
I certainly agree with the proper education. On the other hand, I do see the military involvement coming. I don't like it. I don't like it at all, but I just don't know what we can do about it. So I personally think it's going to happen.
All right, we've explored a number of topics and issues today. Our time to end this interview is beginning to draw near, but I wanted to give you both one last opportunity to reflect back over your life, your contribution to technology and history, your hopes and aspirations for the future, and let each of you perhaps make a statement to the public as to how you hope that your contribution has benefited mankind. Mr. Denenberg?
Well, I certainly have had a lot of fun working on all these projects, so that's one thing I have to say. As you know, I haven't mentioned it earlier, but I was working on rockets already before I joined von Braun in Peenemünde. We had our own little rocket field in my hometown, Hanover, where I was brought up. And I have believed in spaceflight all the time, and it's amazing what kind of progress we have made. I don't think that I expected in those days that I would see man walking around on the moon. So that is certainly a great advance we have made in that area. I'm still quite a bit concerned about the military involvement we discussed here last. And as I said earlier, I don't see what can be done in order to really avoid it. I hope we find the ways and means of doing it. That's one great hope I have in our present space station effort. I hope if we can involve enough foreign nations, maybe even the Russians, and hopefully certainly the Chinese, that we really can set up such a joint project that everyone agrees, according to the lines what Dr. Reisig said, that we all get the benefit if we work together. If we try to solve these relatively difficult problems jointly, as a team again, as we had the rocket team in the old days, I think we would be way ahead, and I hope that this new venture now for the United States to build a space station, that it really will be an international effort which will help, hopefully, eventually, to bring about peace on Earth and, of course, in space.
Dr. Reiser?
Well, I'd like to say a few words on two aspects to your question. One aspect is that I'm still and ever will be very grateful to Werner von Braun that he took me into his team. And I have a professional experience I never could have expected. You see, before I joined Peenemünde, I was working in the German industry and a big company, and you were just a little wheel in a big gear, eh? And you had your problems, very intricate problems, but it was very narrow. You had close boundaries in what you are working. When I came to Peenemünde, in particular to a spiritual leader, Werner von Braun, it was, the whole world was open, quite a sudden. So it was most exciting, and I'm really grateful for my professional experience in the space of the area of space technology. The other thing I'd like to address with a few words is the old question, is it worthwhile, let's say, for the nation as a whole, or for even mankind, to go into space activities? And I have a quite earthly view in that, because we have quite a economical struggle to sustain now. How will our economy develop, and what could we expect, particularly from technology, to improve conditions on Earth and make everybody give everybody a good living and make them happy? And if you look at the leading people and the proper literature, it's always said the big things to keep things going is innovations. But you can't take innovations out of a book. You have to go through a real strong and intricate thinking process. And you can't expect too much of imagination if you don't have a big goal, something to go to, in a real large scale. And that's the reason I admired President Kennedy so much. He had a vision for a real big thing. And you were inside it and said, well, I have to find new ways and means to accomplish something. In other words, to come to innovations. And I think that's the biggest benefit of all the space activities, to be such an incentive, to be a big goal, to make people work on something which is worthwhile and which even benefits the little man on the street, so to speak, even if it doesn't realize that. So the justification for efforts, let's say in terms of a taxpayer, would be to get the direction into new things which benefit the nation and the mankind. And for that you need these innovations which only can come from this big goal which is ahead of you. And that's my main what should I say, the main thing I appreciate with any kind of space activity.
Well, it's very interesting, because I believe it was the psalmist that said that where there is no vision, the people perish. And certainly these two gentlemen that have been talking to us today have not only given us a very practical technology, pioneered an age which will be here as long as mankind is here, we hope. They've given us a vision of man's future destiny and purpose in this cosmos. And I want to thank Mr. Conrad Dannenberg, Dr. Gerhard Reisig, for joining us today. And I hope that your visions, your hopes, your aspirations are all realized in the future. Thank you so much.
Thank you.